week's episode of...
Hey, I think we're good here.
I'm one of your co-hosts, Jackson Metakekia.
And I'm Matt West. And we're here getting to know the sport of volleyball through the life experiences our guests have to share with us. Come take a listen. This week's guest is current Stanford athlete, Jaylen Jasper. For those of you tuning in that haven't heard, Stanford recently announced that they will be cutting their men's volleyball program after the 2021 season. We brought Jaylen on to discuss his journey to Stanford, what Stanford means to him, and to tell us and our listeners what is currently going on with the program and how we, the volleyball community, can help. Please listen and help these young men.
Good morning, brother.
Good morning, how are you?
Great, how are you?
Could be better.
For sure.
You know, doing the best I can.
Absolutely. Jaylen, this is Jackson.
What's up, man?
Hi, nice to meet you, Jackson.
Nice to meet you. How you doing?
Good.
How did it start? Like, what? One, you're from Maryland? Are you starting
to play volleyball right now, actually?
That's where you're from. Are you in Annapolis? Yeah. So how did you get started playing volleyball in Maryland? There's only one other guy that I know from Maryland that played volleyball, and it's Aaron Russell. And obviously his brother.
Yeah, that's everyone, everyone knows.
Yeah.
Travis Merwitter.
Oh, Travis Merwitter, too.
Can't forget about him.
But how did you start playing?
Yeah, I was actually a basketball player for 10 years. And it wasn't until I got to high school that I actually like kind of started to pick it up. But when my sister first got to high school, she also made the transition from basketball to volleyball. So that's when the idea first entered my mind. And I would go to like some of her club practices and like just watch. And like it got to the point where like they would ask me if I like wanted to go in and play. So like I started like playing, and then soon enough I started to like it more than basketball just because it was new. Like I kind of lost my passion for it, but like volleyball was right there and it was so like unique, and I guess that's something I've always been like a fan of, is just things that are different. So when I went to high school, I went to a private high school for my first 2 years, and I played basketball my freshman year, and my sophomore year I didn't, and I chose to just play volleyball. And that's kind of when I made the like decision, like, okay, like I'm just gonna go full on with volleyball here and like play basketball like a hobby. And I made the like youth, or no, that's way too early. I was on the like A1 team, like my first year trying out for high performance. The year after that, I think it was either A1 again, or I ended up making the youth team. And that's what put me, I think, on like the map for like college. Just because like the level of playing that we were getting into and like the coaching I was receiving was just so much like better than what I was getting in Maryland. So like I was always pretty athletic because both of my parents were athletes in college. So like I was able to pick up volleyball pretty quickly just being athletic. So I think that was like one of my biggest, like, cause I was still a pretty like raw player. Like I didn't really have all like the technique down, but like I could throw myself across the floor for a ball and I could jump out of the roof. So those were like two of my biggest like attributes coming out of high school. But like as soon as I like knew volleyball is what I wanted to do is when I also started to take school a lot more seriously too, because I knew like if I wasn't playing like a sport that could eventually make me like millions in like the NBA, like I would probably need like a good degree. So I like buckled down in my studies, and eventually when the time came and I had some options for school, I had some really, really good options. But Stanford was always like at the top, obviously, just because of what it was. But yeah.
That's an incredibly rare trait to have as like a 15, 16 year old. We're like, I really want to do this. So not only am I going to go all in on the sport thing, But boy, am I going to go all in on academics too.
Yeah, I know. It was like, I kind of like surprised myself there. Like, I think I matured a lot quicker than a lot of kids, but like, I knew like from a young age that like, as soon as I wanted to start playing volleyball, that I was going to need to like do well in school. So, and I was able to do it obviously because I got in. So like, it kind of shocks me still.
Was there like a major culture shift between basketball and volleyball? Like the style what is like, that? Like, cause I didn't play basketball. Did you play club basketball too?
Yeah. I played AAU for a while. And then 1 year I played on a team that was in the EYBL, which is like the Nike Elite League, whatever. So like, I played like pretty competitively, but like I can only like describe it in contrast to volleyball. Like, I had friends like from like high performance, like across the country, like from everywhere. Like with basketball, like I really only knew like the kids like in my area, like maybe. And then like when we would go to like the big tournaments, like you see like the big name kids, like the like top recruits, and like the like you would go to tournaments and like I would like play against my friends' teams, and like I would recognize their parents, and like it was just like a big family basically. Like everyone just knew each other. Like it was just such a smaller community that like everybody was so much more connected than basketball, which is huge, and it's every man for himself.
Business in basketball starts early, man.
Yeah. My dad's a football coach, so he originally tried to get me into football, which just from a young age I knew football is I knew I was supposed to play sports, but I knew football was not it. So I pushed back as hard as I could against it. And I think my dad was probably a little disappointed, but I mean, I still look at where I am now and I hope he's proud of me. But yeah, no. And then like, I started basketball when I was, I think like 8. And then I played until, I played in high school, but I stopped playing competitively my sophomore year of high school. So like, I played for like 10 years.
That's a long time, dude. Was there like a major stigma towards you because you were like a black guy playing basketball, and then you went into volleyball and everybody's like, oh, he's probably a sick athlete, and it just so happens that you fit that criteria perfectly because you are a sick athlete, but like but, like, was there a stigma coming in? Like, could you feel that as soon as you walked into volleyball culture?
I mean, yeah. I remember, like, one of the first comments, like, somebody made to me when I stepped on the one of the courts at a high-performance thing. Like, I was – I don't know how old I was then. And I'm pretty sure, like, the person who said it to me, like, would not say it today. But, like, they made a comment about, like, me being black and, like, certain things in my body being like larger than like other races. And it was just like a very uncomfortable situation. He like said it in front of everybody, and then like he just proceeded to like talk about like how like I'm black, so I can like jump higher and I can do all these other things. And like that was probably like the only one of the only times in my life that like I've ever like heard somebody like say something like that to me. But like I've always heard like comments about like, oh, like he can jump, like he's just so athletic. And like, I've never really been sure if that's because I'm black. But like, I definitely think that just because like, it's not a very racially diverse sport, that there is some like racially charged aspect to it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's a
well said.
Yeah, well said. It's definitely a predominantly white sport. And like, you just, like, you don't see a lot of black athletes in our sport. And when you do, they're fucking really good at it.
Yeah.
You know, and another, it's not because they're black. It's just because they've been given another route instead of, like, oh, I have to play basketball, football. Like, Josh Tuninga was on. And, like, even as a poly guy, he was like, you have to play football. And he's like, I don't want to play football anymore. Like, I just want to play – he's like, I just want to play volleyball.
Yeah, and then what he went and did.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, Chris Austin and Chris Austin. And, yeah, Chris Johnson, both these guys that went to Long Beach City College. Chris Austin ended up winning 2 rings as a setter. And that's a huge stigma, obviously, because setters are, like, supposed to be the brain.
Yeah.
And Chris went in and
very, he was a black setter.
Yeah. I don't know any other black setter now that I think about it.
Okay. There's plenty around the world. But
yeah.
Not
yeah,
plenty,
sure. But in the US now.
I'm trying to think like if I even know any. Interesting. I mean, like, I know some on the women's side.
Yeah, women's side for sure.
In men's.
Dude, the women's is breaking through, though, because it's like there's just so much opportunity in women's sport, obviously. So now it's like giving the black community more of an opportunity because people are willing to, like, help.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, if you feel like you're disenfranchised or, like, you just don't have the money to pay, we will help you, which is great. And if you do have the money, then pay up, just like the rest of us.
Exactly. And then I especially think, like, with everything happening this year, like, going forward, like, I think there's going to be, like, more of a push for things to be, like, more diverse and, like, more inclusive and, like, try to, like, reach wider audiences. So, like, I'm excited to see, like, where, like, diversity goes within our sports, like, men's and women's.
So, what was the culture shift like for you going from Maryland all the way to Palo Alto?
Oh, well, I never really vibed with the East Coast. Like, I hate this place so much, not going to lie. If I had a choice, I would never come back here. Like, the humidity is not my friend. The mosquitoes must really like me because if I step outside for more than 10 minutes, I have 15 bites on each leg. Like, I don't know, like, the pace of life, like, everyone is – like, I feel like people say, like, Californians are uptight here, but, like, that is not true at all. It's, like, people on the East Coast that are uptight, and, like, people here are kind of rude, and, like, the vibe on California is just so much more, like, chill, and everyone's, like, so, like, relaxed, and, like, I don't know, like, it's just, and the weather is so much better, and, like, you're never more than, like, a 45-minute drive from the beach. It's just where I want to be. It's where I want to end up, but definitely it felt like I was going home, like I was leaving this place that I was just being trapped in because my dad's a football coach at the Naval Academy, and like going back to like where I actually like fit in, because I wear shorts and flip-flops and like a button-down Hawaiian shirt like pretty much every day during the summer, and like people here would be like staring at me and I was like, what's going on? And then like I go like that California, like people aren't even wearing shirts. It's like I'm the weird one for like having anything on. So I like California and like just the West Coast so much better.
What was like the defining factor? Obviously Stanford speaks for itself, but like was there like a, do you remember something that just hit like the nail in the coffin for you in your recruiting process where you're like, I'm going to Stanford for sure?
I mean, like I always knew that like academically, like you said, like it was gonna be like one of my top choices, but like on a bunch of my visits, like I didn't really, I don't want to say get along with the team, like I just something didn't feel right. But when I walked on to the campus, like it just, and like the coaches and the players and like the time that I spent like out with them, like it was just everything felt so right, and like I felt like I was home. Like it was like, it really was a family, like they described it. And just like the people that I met were just like unreal. Like they were like millionaires, self-made by the age of 20, or like they were like curing cancer, doing something like that. And it was just like everyone was like that. And like, at first it was like a little scary, like, could I go to school here? Like the only thing I've done in high school is play sports, but like I knew just like being around those people like all day every day for 4 years and now 5, like it's just gonna make me like that much better and like that much like, I don't know, like smarter, I guess. So like as soon as I like was like talking to everybody and like I just saw like how smart and how like together was, I knew like it was for me.
You're right. You were a lot more mature than most teenage guys. Having that perspective at that age is awesome.
Dude, when I went on my visit to Stanford, I remember Ken Shibuya. I remember this so vividly. He was like, we have the youngest kid to ever climb Everest. And we have And I remember that one. I was like, he's 17. He climbed Everest. And then he mentioned two other kids that were like world-class or whatever else they did. And he's like, and everybody has this phenomenal story. And your story could be volleyball. And I was like, that's the worst story ever, man. That's what you want my story to be.
No, that totally sounds like something Booyah would say, though.
Yeah, I was so like,
make you feel better, but it, like, it's like, that doesn't make me feel better at all.
Yeah, I was like, you lost me, dude. I was like, this is definitely not the place for me. But having been around Maddie, Bug, my girlfriend, and her, what she says about Stanford, like, your guys' perspective on, like, how to get there and, like, being there is so similar. Because she was in the same boat. I don't know how it was for you. I guess it's probably different for the men's game. But were you also equally as stressed your junior year about your grades and your senior year about grades?
Yes. Oh, my God.
Like, yeah. Like, she was like, I almost cried. She filled out her application, and she did her, like, birthday wrong. And then you only get one, right?
Oh, no.
So she was – and you have to do it in pen. And, like, it's not like yeah. you can write it out or anything. So she said she just broke down crying. She was like, there's all this work for nothing. And, like, I can't go to Stanford now.
Oof. Oh, I feel so bad. I remember the anxiety filling out that application. Awful.
I guess, like, when, after you committed, because most people when they commit and, like, you're signed, for me, I was, like, senioritis to the max. I'm a senior. I'm a cool guy. With your senior year, were you in the same boat, or you're like, okay, now I have so much pride going into Stanford that, like, I'm going to kick ass in everything I do and make – everybody recognized this is why I'm going to Stanford? Or were you also like a part of the senioritis crew like the rest of us?
No, I was 100% the person that, like, I was pretty low-key about it, but like I took a full schedule as opposed to like all my friends that took like half schedules was in like classes. So it was definitely like a me trying to like prove myself, because I also remember like when I committed to Stanford, I had a few issues with some people like saying things behind my back, like just like totally uncalled for. And like, I called them out on it and they were just, oh, like, I'm sorry, I didn't mean that, or I didn't say that. And I was just like, okay, whatever. But like, that just kind of like flipped a switch in my mind. Like, okay, like, wow. Like, if they're doubting me, like, are other people doubting me? Like, all right, well, like, no, like, that's not how this works. Like, I'm going to Stanford for a reason. Like, I worked hard to get to where I am, and like, I'm going to prove that to you guys. So like, I didn't have too many friends my senior year, but I got like great grades my entire year. I was in school from 7 till 2 o'clock. That's when it is. And I was, I don't know, we did Latin honor system. I got the gold sash thingy that's hanging right here. And I left to Stanford. I never looked back. I like pretty much unfollowed everyone from my high school on Instagram. Like after that, like I was so done. Like I didn't want to be like a part of that at all. But like my senior year, I like full on like buckled in and like, I'm getting ready for Stanford. Like, let's do this.
That's pretty sick. Good for you, dude. Well done.
I mean, it's good, but, like, then I come home and I have, like, no one to hang out with.
You're like, I just told everybody to fuck off, and now nobody's around anymore.
Yeah, no, it's, like, kind of shitty.
Do you ever look back and regret it now that, like, you're a little bit more removed and you have some perspective to be like, I should have just been silent and done my work and quiet, and then people would have just seen it?
I mean... like maybe, but also like at the same time, like no one in my class went to an Ivy League school. Like no one went to like a school like Stanford. Like I was exactly that was what I did. I was just like, don't mind me. But nobody, like I went to the best school out of anyone in my class. So like I did have a bit of a chip on my shoulder. I was like, none of you are doing this, like whatever. But like I look at where I am now and like where I can go and like the doors that have been opened for me. And like, I see like what some of the people from my high school are doing, like hanging out with the exact same people, going to like the same places, like just so like complacent with life. And like, it just like, I don't regret anything I did. Like sometimes it is a little lonely, but like I see everything I have in front of me, and like I'm 21 years old. Like I have a long life ahead of me. Like I'm pretty excited.
And you'll have a Stanford degree.
Exactly. And that is what I'm so excited for. Like, you know, like graduate, like if I don't have volleyball my senior year or my fifth year, whatever, like whatever, but like I'm gonna graduate with a Stanford degree. Like that is like, oh, like I put in so much work. Thank God.
So then what was, walk us through your freshman year and like coming in, and you're like, obviously you're probably so excited because you're like, I'm finally out of this place, out of Maryland. I'm finally with my guys. Was it as good as you thought it was going to be? Was it better than you thought it was going to be? Or like, was it harder than you thought it was going to be?
Well, originally I went during the summer quarter, during like the summer after I graduated. Like I graduated and then a few weeks later I ended up going to campus. Okay. I think it was like my essay score and the SAT was not like as good as they thought it could be. So they had me like take a writing class on campus the summer before. So like I actually got to like experience a little bit of what campus would be like before like everyone got there. Yeah. So I got to like learn where like all the buildings were and like the facilities and like where I'd be living and like kind of figure everything out without a ton of people there and like feeling a bunch of like pressure and like everyone watching me. So like that was pretty nice. So like when the school year started, I had like a good idea of like the campus, but like still like I was in a completely new place, like with all these geniuses that I knew I was going to be surrounded by, but like now it was like super intimidating. And then like I have like the athletics, and like I walk into the football room, or the football room, it's what it feels like, the training room, and the football players are like just massive and huge, and it's just like, Jesus, like am I gonna turn into that like after 4 years? But I mean, obviously not. Like there were a lot of like moving parts to it. Like my freshman year academically was also a little hard, just because that's also when my brother almost died and got a heart transplant.
Okay.
So I was dealing with that quarter. And then like dad had like my first season and like everything, like that was my freshman year. And wow, now that I look, yeah, I moved in by myself because my parents had to stay in the hospital with Jaren because he was on life support. Like, yeah, now that I think about it, my freshman year kind of sucked.
Most people does, but yours sounds exceptionally shitty.
Wait, yeah, that actually really fucking sucks. I totally forgot about that. Yeah, no, that's when my freshman year, that summer when I went in, that's also the year that we went to world championships, and Jaren went in for his routine heart procedure. It went horribly wrong, dead for 15 minutes, got a heart transplant, but like that was all my freshman year. And then I remember that week, we played UC Irvine is when he actually got the heart, and I flew back to Maryland to like see him when he woke up from surgery and everything. And then I ended up flying back to California a few days later to play in that game. So that was a fun year.
Please tell me you went off.
I didn't play the first set, but I think the second, I'm pretty sure we got swept, but no, that was our freshman year. We sucked.
Yeah. Like I didn't want to bring it up, but yeah, you guys weren't amazing, yeah, but you never know.
Year. So that was also fun, but no, I think I played decently well during that game.
What's one thing that you can, obviously from all that adversity you take on your freshman year, is there one thing that stands out to you experience wise where like that part of it I will absolutely never forget, and like it's kind of transformed you and you felt it like over time now?
I'm trying to think, because I know like there are so many things that have happened. Like each year that I've been at Stanford, like it's been a different roller coaster. Like I said, my freshman year it was Jaren. Sophomore year it was like just like our team was constantly injured, And I think that was the year that like I was still like really trying to figure out like what I wanted to major in, and I still really didn't have that good an idea, which was not fun. And then this year it was COVID, which I don't have to get into because we all understand that. Like major, okay, this is like not really volleyball related.
That's great. Yeah. Just give it to us.
There was one night that I went to a party with one of the girls on the women's team, and I was like hammered, like completely blackout, like not, it was bad. And I ended up like falling off of the third floor of a building and landing like parallel to the ground. And like, I should bring up the picture because like my face was like smashed. I had like a really, really bad concussion. Like I woke up the next morning in bed just like completely confused as to how I was there. Like I opened Snapchat and I saw like blood all over my face, and that's not good. Went to my trainer, like busted lip. They thought my nose was broken. They like gave me like Alzheimer's medication because my concussion was so bad. Like it was like that, like that's not volleyball related, but I remember like when that happened, like I just kind of like took a step back and was like, how did I get to this point? And that was like my freshman year, like really coming to a just like a big event, because like I was just going through so much and just suppressing a lot of my emotion and not letting a lot of things get to me, because like our season was crappy and I was just like, okay, like screw it, like volleyball's done, like my career is over, I'm never gonna recover from this, I'm the worst volleyball player ever. And then like I almost failed one of my classes winter quarter that year too, which was the first time in my life that it had ever happened. So like that on my transcript, I'm just like, no one's ever going to hire me. Like I'm going to be poor, living on the side of the street for the rest of my life. And then like that happened. And I'm just like, okay, so like I'm finding these like horrible outlets for my like feelings. And like now, like it's actually affecting like my volleyball career, like my academic career, and just like me in general. Like I fell off of a third story building. So like after that is when I really like decided to like get my life together, and like I started like working out more. I got like really into yoga, like started running, just like being healthier. I drank only water. I don't know, like that point in time, like I also just like realized that like college was also getting to me, and I was letting like the social scene of things like blind the whole reason why I was there, which was for school and for volleyball. So I also like yet again had to have another like, it's time to like get serious in school and to get serious in volleyball again. So like after like I wasn't concussed anymore and I could get back to like actually playing and like doing things normally, like I know like a switch was flipped and I was just more focused on volleyball and school. And like if I had time to socialize, like great, but like it never really was a question like where my priorities were. And like, yeah, like I slipped up like a few times, but like I feel like I can admit when I'm wrong, and I also have a good sense of when I know I'm making bad decisions. So like at least I have that going for me. Like if I can identify making a bad decision, like that's better than making a bad decision thinking it's a good one. So
for sure, dude. And that's like that's a great message for anybody watching, because we all fall off the wagon. All, and I did the same thing. I'm not gonna say his name, Jackson knows who it was, but like we were out partying one day, and it was right after like my girlfriend of 5 years had just broken up with me. We didn't make it to the Final Four. All these things were like adding up, and I had this pressure. And I'm sure you had that same pressure going into your freshman year of you're the number one recruit in the country. You're on the youth national team. You're going to Stanford. There's all these expectations. And I remember I literally came crashing down on my face. And
oh,
like,
geez.
Yeah, like I was so drunk, man. And this kid like pulled my head over, or my shirt over my head. and he just let me go, and I literally smashed my face. And like, so the next day you have to go into practice, or it was 2 days, you got to go into practice, and you're like, here's the deal, this is what happened, right? But like, and you, it's literally like rock bottom. And like, the crazy part is and I don't know how it was for you, and you said like you've hit other divots in the road, but like, that's like the first big one. And then for some reason, it's like God's got to test you, or whoever's got to test you, whatever his name upstairs is. And like, you just keep hitting them.
Yeah.
It makes you better. You come out tougher.
It really does. Like, I've seen like some of the things like I've had to come like go through, and like now I'm seeing like what I'm going through now, and I just know like in a year or two, like 5 years ago, I never would have expected myself to be here. And I'm sure 5 years ago I had problems that I thought were going to like completely just upend my life and I would never recover. So like, who's to say like 5 years from now I won't be somewhere else, like doing just fine, like worrying about something that's like at the time is going to be like super important, like this could ruin my life. But then like 5 years later I look back and I can say like, hey, like I guess it wasn't that big a deal. So I know, like, I'm also like taking things like slowly, and just like I have some comfort in knowing that like I'm gonna get through this, and when I do, like I'm gonna be like a much stronger person because I've already seen like what I've done and come through so far.
Absolutely. At least you can say like, I've done it before, I can do it again.
Yeah.
And like Jackson and I always talk about it, and it's like, it hurts to say it in the moment, but after, like when somebody tells you, they're like, dude, in 5 years, you're going to laugh at this. You're going to look back in 5 years and this is actually going to be funny. And you're like, no, it's not. It's the end of the world, man.
No, like people literally started saying that to me like so often that like I just picked it up and I start telling it to myself now. Like, like that was everyone's go-to phrase for some reason for a stretch there. It was just like, in 5 years you won't even worry about it. I'm not sure if that was like a meme or something or why that happened, but like I do remember that. Like that was a big phase in my life and everyone was saying that.
Was there like, I don't know if you recognize it when you walk on campus, but like, do you know Inky Ajoniku by chance? Or
yes.
You know, okay. So Inky and Maddie are really good friends and they talk all the time on FaceTime. And obviously we've been talking a lot more as of recently with like the BLM movement. And she was talking about how she just did not recognize like who she was on campus. Cause she just thought like she was just another person. And then moving back to the South, she was like, oh, and she ended up moving to Brooklyn recently. And she didn't realize how like being anonymous and being in a Black community actually felt. And have you ever felt like how you haven't been able to have a lot of like, what's it called? Anonymity? At Stanford as like a tall Black athlete and walking around, and do you ever feel like I can't escape like just being me for like a hot second?
Honestly, yeah. Like when I walk around like anywhere here, like I definitely like notice like people staring a lot more than like when I'm on campus. But like on campus, like it's like not that bad. Like I step off campus and go to like some places around campus, like it's not as bad as it is here, just because like I'm sure people recognize that Stanford's right down the street and like athletes exist. But like I come here where I think like I'm probably the only 6-7 Black guy within like a 5 to 10 mile radius. So like I walk into Safeway or just like anywhere, and like I can see people through their masks just staring, just like looking at me as I go by. And like sometimes like I'll wear Stanford stuff and like people will ask me like, oh, like do you play basketball, oh, like do you play football, and I'm just like, no, like I play volleyball. And they're just like, oh, like where are you from? I'm like, I literally live like 2 minutes away from here. They're like, oh, like volleyball, like that's interesting. But that's besides the point. But yeah, no, like definitely just being like 6-7 and Black, like I thought like wearing a mask and like sunglasses would like keep me from like being like seen, but like I also forget that, you know, I'm just three heads taller than anyone else. And like I'm just a very large person. Like I don't recognize it until like I see myself in pictures next to people. Yeah. But like I'm just like being around like my teammates all the time, I forget that I'm just like comparatively larger than the average human being.
Yeah. Yeah. Significantly. So then like going forward in your career, what year did you feel like was your breakout? Where you're like, all right, this is an acceptable level of play for me now. That's usually your breakout year is when you're finally like, it's your like, I have arrived kind of moment. Do you remember your breakout moment or like your breakout year?
Honestly, like I still feel like my freshman year, that was probably like the year that I was happiest with that way I played, probably because I was a freshman and I had like no expectations for how I should play.
Yeah.
Like I didn't expect to start, like I didn't expect to get as much playing time as I did, but I don't know, like I played a lot. Like there were a few games where I had like 20 plus kills, and I think I won like player of the ABCA player of the week 1 week, which was a big deal at the time. And like I like was just surprised. I was like, wow, like this is great. And then like I won a year and I was just like, oh, I'm a freshman, like I shouldn't have gotten that, great, like I guess like it's only up from here. So then like sophomore year, like everyone was injured, so like we were changing the lineups constantly and we never really had a setter, and I was going like back and forth between outside and opposite and hitting on both sides of the net. So like I felt like I wasn't getting, like we were playing like a game of like see what positions can do what in what game, as opposed to like playing volleyball like as a team, like what we've been practicing for the whole fall.
Say, like playing Stanford volleyball.
Yeah, exactly. And like that's what that year felt like to me. And then I ended up getting honorable mention at the end of that year too. So like I kind of felt like, you know, like I didn't improve and like I'm not getting any better. Like I remember like when that came out, like I actually was like, I know I should have been happy with it, but I was like heartbroken. I was like, wow, like this is a slap to the face. Like I have not gotten any better. Like I'm a terrible volleyball player. Like I need to quit while I'm ahead. So like sophomore year, like it was like, I definitely had like some ups and some downs, but like overall, like I think because like I did well my freshman year and like I did probably well again my sophomore year, but I didn't do as much better as I would have liked. Like I thought like I wasn't improving and it was almost like a waste of time. And then this year really didn't exist because we didn't really get to play, and I was also hitting off of my libero for like half of the season, and our outside who then ended up blowing his knee out. So like a lot of my time at like Stanford has been like trying to figure out like positions and lineups just because everyone keeps getting hurt and like no one seems to be healthy and everything just seems to not line up when season comes around. But like freshman year, like we had like a solid lineup. Like Paul went down and that was pretty much it. And then I know like one of our outsides also went down, but like it didn't feel like I was an opposite the whole year doing the same thing. So freshman year felt a lot better than my sophomore year. And then this year, which I'm not even sure if this counts.
Yeah, big asterisk next to this season. But hopefully your last year as a volleyball player at Stanford is going to be the best one yet.
I'm really hoping so. Like, I hope it even happens. Like, with the way things have been going right now and just the way people are talking about returning to campuses in the fall, like, and the Ivy League canceling football and all fall sports, like, I don't know, like it's like I'm very unsure. Like I'm hoping for the best but expecting the worst.
Yeah. I hope you guys win a fucking ring. I think everybody in the volleyball community right now is a Stanford Cardinal. Yes.
In the
men's volleyball community, women's volleyball, who cares about women's volleyball, but in the women's volleyball community, I don't know, but in the men's volleyball community, it
would be so dope.
The amount of like change.org links that have popped up and it's a Stanford Cardinal sign on my Facebook, I'm like, this is amazing. How many people want to see this team thrive?
I'm telling you, like, the volleyball community is just so much more like together than like a community like basketball. Like basketball, like people would only sign petitions and do something like at the NBA or like, I don't see, well, I guess March Madness was different with COVID, but like, I wouldn't see like if a school like dropped a basketball program, like people doing this, like there are people like from men's teams, women's teams, like everyone like around the country, like signing the petition, like DMing me, telling me like, what can I do to help? Like, who can I send this to? Like it's just like amazing. Like what the volleyball community is like doing and like coming together like right now to like support us and like try to get us reinstated. It's ridiculous. Like the picture I posted on Instagram almost has more likes than I do followers. Like it's getting to like 6,000, like 500, and I have 6,000, like 500 followers on Instagram. Like, I don't know how the hell that happened, but like the volleyball community is the best community. Like, changed my mind.
So what are some of the things we can do to help out? I've seen those same petitions online as well, but is there anything you have from the inside that can help out?
Like right now, we're just trying to like reach as many people as we can, just because like the university is not being very cooperative with letting teams explore their own options as far as like sustaining themselves. So like, we're just trying, like, we know, like, if we want to get men's volleyball reinstated, we'll also have to get like a women's sport reinstated, which like, I think should, like, I don't want to like pick and choose. Like, if it was up to me, like, reinstate all 11 effing sports. Like, it's Stanford. Like, you have a $30 billion endowment. Like, you pride yourself on academic and athletic excellence, like in your mission statement, but you're going to go ahead and let the university like take away like something that is like so important to us. And like, it's a part of our identity. And like, you're just like going to sit by and like let that happen. And then like, as far as like men's volleyball goes, like the sport is like pretty small as it is, like what, like 23, like 24 Division I schools. Like, yeah, you take one out, like that's going to start to encourage other teams to start dropping their programs. Yeah, like, soon, like men's volleyball might not even exist like in college at all. Like,
yeah. And we were already like, talking about that.
Yeah, like, I don't know how people are supposed to, like, go play overseas if they can't play, like, professionally, because, like, how are you going to, like, get to college and, like, play sports? Like, I don't know. Like, it's a whole, like, mess of a situation, and Stanford is really, like, disappointing me with, like, the response that they've had to, like, a lot of things that have gone on this year. But
I feel really bad for you guys in wrestling. The other ones, like, synchronized swimming and field hockey – like, that's kind of, it feels like more of a club-esque sport to me.
The one that bothers me is fencing. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I really don't know any fencers. I have friends on the synchronized swimming team, believe it or not. and I actually have friends on the, like, sports that are, like, not really sports at Stanford. You know, like, teams that don't win national championships, like soccer, basketball, or football. Like, we all have, like, our own little community. So, like, I have friends on, like, the synchro team and, like, the field hockey team. But, like, I don't know any of the fencers. Like, they don't even use any of the facilities, but, like, they go into, like, the weight room and take our food and then just walk out without saying anything to anyone. And, like, they don't look like athletes. I'm just like, what are you doing here? Like, just – and then they, like, they wait in line and, like, they don't know what to do because they don't use our facilities. So it's just, like, they're taking up space. But – I agree, like, with some of the other sports, I'm like, eh, but, like, men's volleyball, like, with, like, I don't know, it's, like, an Olympic sport, and, like, we have, like, Olympians and, like, gold medalists, and...
And it's a sport that's growing for, like, boys volleyball is growing.
Yeah, exactly,
by the numbers.
you look overseas, like, and it's like football doesn't exist anywhere else. Like volleyball, like men's volleyball is like up there and like some of like most popular sports in other countries, like, except for the United States. Like surprise. Like it's just like volleyball is like so slept on in this country. Like it is, like everyone loves women's volleyball. Like that, I understand that. Like I like watching women's volleyball, but like men's volleyball, like
it's way sicker. Like
equally
way sicker. Popular,
not more.
Don't hate on women's volleyball.
It's
Matt.
Not no women's volleyball is dope for sure. Like if I was looking at it from a purely spectator standpoint, I would rather watch women's volleyball because of the rally duration, for sure. That is true. It's like for sure, but. When it comes down to, like, would I rather watch the semifinals of a women's game or a men's game in the Olympics, 10 times out of 10, I pick the men's game because it's an Olympics and I know they're given everything. And all of a sudden, for some reason, when everything's on the line, men become the best defenders in the world. And then, like, it looks like Wilfredo Leone's, like, roll shotting and guys are just, like, laying out. Like, I remember I saw Sander dive for like the second time ever, and it was in the Olympics. And I was like, "Oh my god, dude, he's doing it! He's moving!"
Well, we're recording this on July 10th. I think I found out about the Stanford situation 2 days ago. When were you guys as athletes notified, and by who?
I was out to breakfast with my parents. It was around like 11-ish here, I want to say. And I got an email from Bernard saying that we were going to be having like a important time sensitive Zoom meeting in like an hour. And I was like, oh, like it's in an hour. Like this must be pretty important. Like I didn't think of reaching out to any of my teammates or like any other teams to see like if any other teams had received this email. But like it was that morning, and I think they said it was like 9 o'clock there, but it was almost noon here. Like I got on the Zoom, and then he said, like, as soon as he said to the 11 sports that were on this call and specified that there were only 11, like I knew like it was not gonna, like something was wrong. I was just like, okay, like that's not what I wanted to hear. And then he used the word discontinued, and like everything just kind of went like mute, and like I was just like, okay, so like volleyball doesn't exist. And I don't really know what he said the rest of the meeting, just because I was like staring at his face and like watching his mouth make words, but like I just couldn't hear anything. It was just like, okay, like wow, like COVID first, like my season gets taken away from me, I get kicked off campus, and like I have to leave California, like now I'm stuck in Maryland, like I might not be able to go back in the fall, and now you're telling me that like my fifth year, like the 1 year that I thought I was gonna get to like return to school and like not have like any problems with anything, is like I'm not going to have volleyball. It was just like, I'm going to stop asking, can 2020 get any worse? Because it has proven every time that I ask that it can. So like, I'm just not excited for what is next. But yeah, it was like, to answer your question, it was 9 a.m, like 2 days ago.
What is Costi said? And for those who aren't, or who are like new and don't know Costi, he's the nicest guy in the world. He's just a total sweetheart. So I can only imagine like the pain he had when he had to like talk to you guys.
Like I remember like the Zoom meeting that we had like that night with like the parents. Like I could tell, like I'm not sure like if he was doing this for like internet purposes or whatever, but like his camera kept turning off and like on when like he wasn't talking, or like when somebody would say something that I thought was like, wow, like that was powerful, like his camera would go off. So like, I don't know like how hard he really took it, because like he does like a really good job of like making sure that like he's like the rock for us, because like he called every single one of us, and like our coaches have been like reaching out to us. So like they're like trying to say like as strong in this like as possible. But like, if you think about like what really happened to like him, like he just like lost his job. That's huge. Like he has a family. Like I'm just in college. Like I'm not going to get to play volleyball. Like that's one problem, but like losing like your job and like that is like a completely different problem. Like I love my coach so much. So like, it like breaks my heart, like thinking that like he is taking this harder than I am possibly.
I think a lot of people are feeling for him and the whole staff right now.
Like, it's just like, I can't believe, like, to all the, like, 11 teams and, like, the 240 athletes and the 22 or 20 coaches, like the 20 coaches, like, specifically, like, they, like, give so much, like, time of their lives to, like, help, like, these athletes, and, like it's, like, their livelihood. It's, like, what they do and, like, what they're passionate about. Like, they wouldn't be doing it, like, if, like, they didn't care. And, like, now, like, just so abruptly and so, like, unsympathetically and, like, without even giving us, like, maybe, like, a little wiggle room to, like, explore alternative, like, it just feels like the ultimate form of, like, disrespect to, like, these people and everything that they have done, like, for the school.
How long has John been there?
You know, this is a question that I should know the answer.
It's got to be 20-something years. He's over post-Dawn.
Like, I'm not going to call my coach old, but, like, he has been there for a while.
Yeah, because he was – he's a Santa Barbara grad, and then he ended up going to Stanford as the assistant and then took over for Dawn when Dawn stepped down.
Yeah.
So it's been a while because Dawn stepped down in, like, the mid-2000s.
Yeah. Oh, I should know that too. I feel really bad. I don't know.
Yeah. Like, yeah, I think he stepped down mid-2000s. So.
Yeah. So he's been there at least 13 years. National
championships.
He's, yeah. I don't know, dude, but we got to bring back worst to first.
Yeah. No. Like, how sick would that be if, like, this next year we, like, came out and just, like, ran shit and then ended up, like, winning a natty.
I'm bringing it back, dude. Worst to first. That was their thing when they won it in 2010, right? Was worst to first?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, that would be so unbelievably sick. Like, that would be, like, they could make a movie about that.
Yeah. I'll produce it. Don't worry. We're putting it on Zoom. Yeah. Well, dude, Jaylen, I think we're good here, man. That was great.
Yeah. Okay. Awesome. Like, if there's literally anything else you need me to, like, say or do or anything, like, totally fine. But, like,
is there, I mean, what else can we do? Can we do anything besides, like, signing these petitions, or do we just need to, like, start sending hate mail, or what's the deal?
I think, like, the next step we're, like, as a volleyball, like, cause we have, like, a good email chain going with, like, some people who actually work in, like, personal relations and, like, social media and, like we're writing, like, a something for, like, the New York Times and, like, really, like, trying to, like, make it, like, a big deal. So, like I don't even know, just, like me, like, doing this and, like, asking me to just, like, talk, like, that is amazing for me, just getting to vent, basically, and, like, let people hear. So, like, thank you for that. I'm trying to think if there's, like, really anything else, but, like, I don't know, like, soon we're going to start, like, making, like, templates to, like, send to, like, the athletic department and the university. So when we get those up and going, I will definitely let you know.
Yeah. And we'll tag you when we post this video on Instagram, so people have your handle and all that. And yeah, any resources or anything that can help, just post on there. And that's kind of a good start for us.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah, we just want to keep this thing pumping, and, like, for me, I'm the same way, because I'm a kid from Seattle, and there's only 8 kids that ever played in, like, my whole state, so I'm, like, the volleyball community means a lot to me, because it's done so much, especially the men's volleyball community, has done so much for me and given me so much, so... Like, anything that I can do or that Jackson can do, I'm guessing, to, like, help our community stay strong, we're doing it.